Colorama, a recorded books hybrid imprint, presents Charlie Brown's America, The Popular Politics of Peanuts, by Blake Scott Ball, read by Johnny Heller. Introduction. Charlie Brown had a hard time choosing sides. This was always part of the humor of his character. It was also one of the many things he hated about himself. One New Year's Eve, he decided to change it once and for all. In 1965, he would be decisive, clear-cut, and well-grounded, and resolved to be strong and firm. Ever the realist and always happy to burst Charlie Brown's bubble, Lucy would not let the boy deceive himself with such an impossible resolution. "Forget it," she blurted. "You'll always be wishy-washy." Charles M. Schulz, the creator behind the comic strip Peanuts, often described his work the same way. "One of the remarkable things about the strip," stated one interviewer in 1987, "is that there are no perceivable ideologies." Schulz agreed. "Sort of a wishy-washiness," he chuckled. Often the humble Midwestern cartoonist seemed to deploy such statements as a defense mechanism to avoid staking a definite position on a controversial topic. But it was more than that. Wishy-washiness was his ideology. In practice, Schulz was a sort of political chameleon, shifting left and right within the bounds of the broad middle of American political culture during the Cold War era. He was adept at creating scenes that acted as Rorschach tests for readers, broaching a controversial issue but leaving enough ambiguity for readers to see whatever excited or disgusted them. Between 1950 and 2000, Schulz reflected and amplified a complex range of popular feelings on issues from civil religion, racial integration, and women's rights to fears of capitalism's decline, environmental degradation, and the Vietnam War through his cartoons. A number of commentators, however, accused Peanuts of being too aloof from the most serious national and global events of its time. Social ethics professor Roger Shin of Union Theological Seminary faulted Peanuts for being too detached from real-world problems. The Boston Post asserted that in the midst of wars, rumors of wars, clamor and controversy, Peanuts was an escape hatch into a make-believe world of serenity and laughter. Even at the end of the strip's 50-year run in national syndication, as Americans mourned Schulz's retirement announcement and attempted to interpret his legacy, journalists still viewed Peanuts as largely apolitical. Inflation and other current events, wrote Newsweek's Mary Voberil in late 1999, seldom invade the gentle provinces of the strip. In her reading of the series, the most pressing issues in post-war American politics were missing from the period's most read newspaper comic strip. Hippies, Vietnam, Watergate, Iran-Contra, CIA spy scandals, impeachments, elections, she listed to prove her point, never found a topical home here. Schulz often seemed to confirm this line of reasoning. A personally conservative man, he always thought of himself as a businessman first and foremost. His primary job, he believed, was to help sell newspapers. Controversial political positions were the quickest way to undermine a comic strip's popular appeal, he believed. "You're being hired by a newspaper editor, and he buys your strip because he wants to sell his newspaper," Schulz explained to one interviewer. "So why should you double-cross him by putting in things that will aggravate him? That's not my job." In his mind, he went to great lengths to avoid controversial issues. "I lean over backwards to keep from offending anybody," he told a reporter for the Milwaukee Journal. Yet Schulz regularly addressed controversial issues in his comic strip, animated television programs, and feature films. At the peak of Peanuts' popularity, Schulz's thoughts on such issues reached over 100 million readers each day. It is possible to pinpoint exactly how some readers interpreted Peanuts because they told Schulz. By 1971, Schulz was receiving as many as 100 new fan letters every day. While not all of this correspondence survived years of spring cleaning and storage, as well as a fire that claimed his first California studio in 1966, a sizable collection of letters has survived and are maintained in the Charles M. Schulz Museum and Research Center in Santa Rosa, California, just down the road from the artist's second studio. This book relies heavily on those collections to uncover readers' thoughts about Peanuts and how they saw it interacting with the Cold War world. This book also draws from numerous interviews, articles, speeches, private letters, and oral histories to try and understand what Schulz was thinking, both when he produced the art and when he encountered others' interpretations of his work. Finally, it investigates various public appropriations, both legal and extra-legal, of Schulz's characters and concepts to see how his work took on a cultural life far beyond the newspaper page or television screen. In many cases, the Peanuts characters became repositories for and expressions of Americans' dreams, hopes, fears, and worries. In doing so, Charlie Brown's America demonstrates that Peanuts was never simply an escapist endeavor, but regularly touched on the lived experience of socially and politically conscious Americans in the post-war era. While Peanuts readers of differing political stripes regularly wrote in to argue with Schultz about the ideas they saw in his work, what is most revealing is how often people of opposing viewpoints loved the same comic strip, but for contradictory reasons. Walt Kelly, a former Disney cartoonist who became famous in the 1950s for his political satire comic strip Pogo, has been credited by one scholar with providing, in his strip, a rallying point around which like-minded people could gather. Schultz provided the opposite, a rallying point around which people of diverse opinions could gather and debate. This book is not a biography, at least not one of Charles Schultz. If anything, it is a biography of Peanuts' cultural life, both in the minds of the creator and his audience, as well as in the world outside the close-knit community of fan and idol. In this way, the characters are treated as both the creation of the cartoonist and also as public symbols who took on a life of their own after leaving the printing press. While Peanuts may be the most successful example of the comic strip medium, it was deeply rooted and inseparable from the history of the art. Comic strips evolved from the raucous visual world of 1890s advertising as newspaper moguls sought to expand their readership and burgeoning corporations reached for a means to capture public attention and private dollars through recognizable characters. In the rapidly urbanized and industrialized 19th century United States, comic strips and illustrated advertising served as an indispensable visual guide to life in the multicultural, multilingual melting pot of American cities. In this context, the symbols of comic arts became a sort of linguistic mediary between the wide range of peoples in turn-of-the-century America. It is no coincidence, then, that comic strip characters like Buster Brown easily danced between the funny pages and mass advertising. The approval of a recognizable cultural figure could often be just the impetus a wary consumer needed to try out a new product. Integral to the success of the American comic strip was a characteristic comic scholars call polysemy. This meant that the same character or scene could be reasonably read in multiple ways by a diverse audience. The more people could relate to a comic strip, the more successful that comic strip could be in sales and marketing. Sometimes this meant using racial, ethnic, or gendered stereotypes to calcify the boundaries of American cultural citizenship. But in the most transcendent works of the comic strip medium, even these exclusionary boundaries could be bridged or dismantled to broaden the audience. Comic strips like Cats and Jammer Kids, Little Nemo in Slumberland, and Crazy Cat all found ways to broaden audiences, whether through including ethnic characters in the American citizenry, traveling through universal dream worlds, or abandoning the world of direct social discourse for the allegories of anthropomorphized animals. Peanuts represents the ultimate perfection of the comic strip medium. Charles Schultz created a comic world so successfully polysemic that it attracted the largest audience in the history of the medium, counting every other American as a daily reader at its height. The comic strip sold newspapers like no other in a time of considerable consolidation and decline in the industry. There are countless stories in the Schultz archive of editors being barraged by complaints when Peanuts was accidentally left out of the final copy of local newspapers, or fans who carried a second newspaper subscription because their local paper did not carry Peanuts. But Schultz's work also sold much more than newspapers. By the 1970s, Peanuts was a multi-million dollar licensing franchise, more visible than any property not owned by Disney. In fact, in Forbes magazine's 2019 report of the top-earning past celebrity estates in the world, Charles Schultz finished third behind only Michael Jackson and Elvis Presley. While many critics over the years lamented Schultz's licensing decisions as a commercial sellout, the truth is that Peanuts actually succeeded more than any other comic strip at doing what comic strips were invented to do, sell. For his part, Schultz always insisted that he kept the comic strip foremost, never allowing the quality to slide. The proof of his commitment was the fact that unlike most successful cartoonists in the industry, he refused to outsource any part of the comic strip to an assistant, whether drafting, inking, or lettering. For nearly 50 years, everything readers saw in the Peanuts comic strip came from the mind and hands of Charles Schultz. Central to Charles Schulz's success was his adept usage of both ambiguity and allegory to create space for multiple interpretations. Ambiguity, or a sort of intentional vagueness on the part of the cartoonist, was key in the way that he often handled religious and philosophical issues. In the foremost examples, such as the October 20, 1963 peanut strip, where Schulz used only 8 words across 11 panels to comment on the controversy over school prayer, the cartoonist's ambiguity was so successful that readers could not agree among themselves where the artist stood on the issue of school prayer. Ambiguity allowed the cartoonist to virtually disappear and leave the readers with a sort of mirror through which they could evaluate their own opinions of the issue at hand. Allegory and Peanuts, on the other hand, utilized readily recognizable symbols and stories, like the World War I Flying Aces dogfights with the historic Red Baron, to enable Schulz to broach enormously sensitive contemporary issues like the Vietnam War. Schulz's innate sense and skill for employing ambiguity and allegory set him apart from his contemporaries, and his mastery of polysemy enabled readers to see the world they wanted to see. And for decades, readers got what they were looking for with the delivery of every daily newspaper. There are at least 3 reasons why a study of Peanuts provides new insights into Cold War America. First, the need for 50 years of daily content required Schulz to be remarkably responsive to the social, political, and cultural changes in American life, as he attempted to deliver his unique voice to an audience that could be a rapidly moving target. Second, the comic strip was capable of eliciting emotional connections to politics that did not always appear in more traditional mediums of debate, providing scholars with a way to think more deeply about the role of emotional lives of Cold War Americans. Third, while the cartoonist tried to be responsive to his audience was also very responsive to him. The decades of fan mail to Schulz includes voices that likely would have never ended up in the archive of a congressman or senator. Many of these people, like Schulz himself, did not consider themselves highly educated or of tremendous importance, yet they felt comfortable to share their deep concerns about their country and the world with their favorite newspaper cartoonist. Peanuts has been woefully understudied for an artifact of such incredible cultural significance. Still, there have been a handful of important studies of Charles Schulz and his work. In 1989, Rita Grimsley Johnson published an authorized biography of Schulz titled Good Grief, The Story of Charles M. Schulz, a popular memoir that had the benefit of extensive interviews with Schulz himself, though Schulz obviously played a considerable role in determining its boundaries. In 2007, David Michaelis was able to delve into some of the darker elements of Schulz's life with his best-selling Schulz and Peanuts. His considerable work in digging up early syndicate correspondence in Manhattan, a collection of documents that became an important part of the opening of the Schulz Museum Archive, was essential in opening the door for studies such as this one. While Michaelis discussed the cultural influence of Peanuts, however, his book tended to focus on the most unseemly and sensational elements of Schulz's relatively tame life and did little to address the later decades of Schulz's career. 2 other recent books have been significant contributions to the study of Peanuts. Stephen Lin's A Charlie Brown Religion offers a religious biography of the cartoonist, while Jared Gardner and Ian Gordon's edited volume, The Comics of Charles Schulz, The Good Grief of Modern Life, was the first concerted effort among critical scholars to analyze the meaning and significance of the comic strips. Still, none of these volumes provided an all-encompassing study of Peanuts' immense place in Cold War American life. The chapters in this book are organized chronologically, each one highlighting an important theme that defined the direction of the Peanuts property in those years. This means that at times, chapters will backtrack to focus on the development of a theme earlier in Schulz's career. Chapter 1 introduces the man behind Peanuts, beginning with his childhood. This biographical chapter follows Charles Schulz through school and his art education. It then delves into the unexpected passing of his mother, his draft orders for the Army and service in World War II. Following the war, Schulz returned home, searching for meaning in life. He found it in evangelical Christianity and in the pursuit of his dream of becoming a nationally known cartoonist. The remainder of the chapter follows Schulz through his surprisingly rapid rise to a nationally syndicated comic strip. Chapter 2 investigates the Cold War origins of Peanuts. The strip in the early 1950s was quite different from what later generations would come to recognize and cherish. During these years, Schulz became a sort of cult hero of existentialism, drawing a strip that could be quite bleak in its meditations about modern life. Issues of social alienation, Atomic anxiety and emotional conflict were common themes of this period, during which Schultz's artistic and literary styles were developing. From early in his career, Schultz attracted considerable attention for some of the deep subjects addressed in his works. Linus's Security Blanket, in particular, became a massive hit with both young parents raising the baby boomer generation and psychologists looking for relatable ways to express the unique psychological issues they were observing in modern life. Schultz's work also ascended to the heights of both his profession and national influence during the 1950s, winning him top accolades among his peers and admiration in the White House. Chapter 3 explores Peanuts' religious commentary. By the end of the 1950s, Cold War America was deep in the throes of a third Great Awakening. This mid-century revivalism had its origins in the nuclear anxieties of the decade and was fueled by a number of middle-class social worries, from racial integration and urban decay to fears of juvenile delinquency and the decline of American culture. These were the same issues addressed in Peanuts as the comic strip made its rapid climb to national prominence. It is not surprising, then, that Schultz's work became overtly evangelical by the end of the decade. And by the middle of the 1960s, Schultz and a growing religious subset in his audience would come to see Peanuts as a lone bastion of evangelical Christianity in American popular culture. This change showed up most drastically in the character Linus Van Pelt, who became America's best-known pop theologian. Linus regularly rebuked, counseled, and corrected his friends with direct quotations from the Bible and his meditations on Christian theology. This new direction in Peanuts increasingly singled Schultz out as a Christian cartoonist and pop thinker. While religion was becoming a central part of Peanuts by the 1960s, racial diversity was not. Schultz had pushed back against gender norms of the mid-20th century, but like all other national syndicated cartoonists in the 1960s, largely avoided the minefield of race and civil rights. By 1968, however, Schultz would become a somewhat reluctant reformer when he introduced the first black regular cast member in a national comic strip. Yet while Schultz was the first to take that step, he would struggle in subsequent years to find an authentic voice and role for his new cast member. Chapter 4 tells this story of integration of Peanuts. In the late 1960s, there is only one issue that could ultimately overtake civil rights as the leading concern for Americans, the Vietnam War. Chapter 5 analyzes Charles Schultz's commentary on the divisive conflict that came to define three presidencies and a generation of young Americans. By the end of the decade, Snoopy had blossomed into a central character in the comic strip. His characteristic daydreams and regular role-playing increasingly set him apart from the other characters in Peanuts, as he imagined a world far larger than theirs. Schultz would openly come to worry that Snoopy might come to overshadow the children, and in many cases in the 1960s, he did. Nowhere was this more true than in Snoopy's Vietnam-era dreams of endless combat and defeat. This chapter tells the story of how Snoopy's war in Peanuts during the 1960s and 1970s became a voice for the desperate anguish many Americans felt as they tried to maintain support for individual soldiers while simultaneously hating the draft and despising the Vietnam War. Chapter 6 delves into the ways that Schultz's personal disenchantment with the role of the federal government was displayed in Peanuts in the 1970s and 1980s. Like much of his audience, Schultz increasingly characterized his understanding of American values in individualistic terms and found subtle ways to vilify government expansion on issues such as environmental protection and abortion rights. This chapter also analyzes three different federal ad campaigns involving Peanuts characters during the Nixon, Ford, and Carter administrations. Dealing with issues of energy consumption, the American economic system, and air pollution, these three campaigns carried a central message of personal responsibility, decentralization, and the power of the individual to shape a better future. There was also a clear emphasis on free market capitalism as the solution to the national problems of consumer waste, stagnation, and environmental degradation. This chapter examines previously unpublished correspondence of the friendship between Charles Schultz and Ronald Reagan, from the latter's governorship to the presidency. Reagan joked with Schultz on the eve of his election in 1980 that Snoopy might be able to undercut his appeal to his base. Reagan even offered the famous Beagle a cabinet position in his administration in exchange for not entering the presidential race. As this chapter demonstrates, Peanuts had close but subtle ties to the rightward shift in American politics. Peanuts, of course, was far from a right-wing ideological publication. But in the 1970s and 1980s, There was a decided shift in tone in Schultz's work that mirrored growing public skepticism of government management and the rising culture wars. As the center moved, so did Peanuts. Chapter 7 turns to feminism, sexuality, and gender identity in the work of Charles Schultz. Peanuts had always been about the battle of the sexes. On October 3, 1950, the second day of the strip, the little girl Patty had skipped down the sidewalk gleefully reciting the children's rhyme, "Sugar and spice and everything nice, that's what little girls are made of," stopping only to emphasize her point by giving Charlie Brown a black eye. Yet it was Lucy Van Pelt who most embodied the characteristics of the powerful female in Peanuts, refusing to accept her prescribed place in society. With all of her strength, Lucy also embodied many negative stereotypes of women in post-war America. As the 1960s progressed, so did Schultz's handling of his female characters, and by the 1970s, Peanuts became intertwined with the feminist movement in the 1970s. Still, some of the most prominent connections between Peanuts and social movements came not from the artist, but from fans, who employed the characters to reflect their own feelings and ideas about the changing times. This chapter will conclude with an in-depth look into how Peppermint Patty and Marcy became important symbols in lesbian publications against Schultz's wishes. In the fall of 1970, as Schultz celebrated the 30th anniversary of Peanuts, a young artist named Gary Trudeau launched Doonesbury, filled with unrepentant, cold sarcasm, and became the voice of a new generation, in the same way Peanuts had once spoken to the alienated and discontented of the 1950s. Charles Schultz despised Doonesbury. Aside from seeming unprofessional and downright disrespectful, in the aging cartoonist's estimation, Trudeau's work rested on what Schultz believed was the cheapest and least durable form of humor, political commentary. Schultz prided himself on building Peanuts on more solid ground, focusing on timeless human experience and eternal values of love, friendship, and hope. But Peanuts was never as timeless as Schultz liked to imagine, not even when it came to politics. The book concludes with a CBS miniseries titled This Is America, Charlie Brown, which aired over the 1988-89 television season. In this program, Schultz tried to encapsulate what he saw as the common history and culture that had brought prosperity to the United States in the 20th century. This program was a unique blend of conservative Christian traditionalism and progressive historical revision. The result was a miniseries, largely panned by critics and audiences alike. By trying to comment to a broad audience, a strategy that had been effective throughout Schultz's career, by the 20th century, Peanuts was losing its prominence. It had fallen out of step with a society in the throes of what historians now refer to as the culture wars. Because Schultz tended to play to the middle and downplay his political opinions, a strategy that had made him a cultural darling for the better part of 40 years, his work now seemed quaint and antiquated in the polarized world of The Simpsons and Pat Buchanan's War for the Soul of America speech. Newspapers like the Chicago Tribune, one of the original seven newspapers to publish Peanuts in 1950, openly called for the retirement of Charlie Brown and the gang. Schultz's strong base of evangelical readers, too, came to question the depth and authenticity of the artist's faith, as he expressed a growing discomfort with evangelicalism's preachiness and insistence on moral conformity. In the end, Schultz found himself right where he had always been, stuck in the wishy-washy middle of the American political spectrum. And where that centrism had actually served as a virtue during the political battles of the Cold War, it left Peanuts without a side in the fever pitch of a new age of open partisanship. The epilogue examines the legacy of Peanuts today. In 2001, ABC purchased the rights to the television specials, and in the 2010s experienced the highest ratings since the premieres in the 1960s and 1970s. In 2015, 20th Century Fox premiered the first feature-length Peanuts movie in over 30 years to great critical and commercial success. That summer, Charlie Brown was once again the focus of American media attention, though in a drastically different political moment than the one he had walked into 65 years earlier. There were signs, however, that he was as relevant as he had ever been. The film inspired a summer trend of Peanuts-themed avatars on Facebook that signaled a clamoring among some Americans for a return to more cordial, wishy-washy political middle in the midst of a historically contentious and crude presidential campaign. It was as though they were joining President Barack Obama as he wrote with longing nostalgia in his introduction to the 25th and final volume of The Complete Peanuts Collection in 2016. Like millions of Americans, I grew up with Peanuts, but I never outgrew it. But in other ways, America did seem to be outgrowing Peanuts. This was most apparent in 2016, when MetLife ended its prominent 30-year advertising deal with Peanuts. Schultz had produced an art empire that had expressed the concerns of Cold War America, but at the same time left a body of work inextricably linked to that past era. Chapter 1. You're a Good Man, Charles Schultz. The Making of an American Original. January 2, 2000, marked a sad beginning to the new millennium, announced Ann Shields of the Los Angeles Times. The melancholy had nothing to do with the long-feared consequences of the Y2K bug or the looming disaster of the dot-com bubble burst. No, it was a sad day because Charles Schultz, creator and artist of the Peanuts comic strip for nearly 50 years, officially retired. For fans of Charlie Brown, Lucy, Snoopy, and all the gang, contract stipulations meant that the end of Schultz's career also signaled the end of Peanuts. Schultz's retirement would leave an immense void, not just in American cultural life, but in the everyday routines of millions of Americans. Schultz's words are read in more homes than many literary giants, Shields wrote without the slightest sense of hyperbole. Peanuts had been such a consistent part of daily life for the last half century. Even an emergency bypass surgery in 1981 had barely slowed the cartoonist's daily output. This loss felt personal. When the cartoonist passed away from complications of advanced colon cancer only 6 weeks later, the night before his final comic strip ran on Valentine's Day, the loss became permanent. Peanuts had made Charles Schultz a millionaire. It had also made him a rather unlikely celebrity. He had been friend to presidents, professional athletes, world-class artists, and musicians. His artwork had been exhibited to international acclaim at some of the most important cultural centers in the world. He had also mentored countless other newcomers to the world of comic strips. He had been a husband, a father of five, and a generous philanthropist to many laudable causes. But for most Americans, he was renowned because he was Schultz, the man who brought those quirky, delightful, sympathetic, vulnerable, and deeply authentic cartoon children to life, every morning in the newspaper and every holiday on television. Post-war Americans had grown up with Charlie Brown and Snoopy and Linus and Lucy and Peppermint Patty and Franklin and all the rest. The end of Peanuts truly marked the end of an era. The end, perhaps, of what Time magazine publisher Henry Luce had famously called the American century. Every story with an ending, of course, had to have a beginning. Charles Schultz's story could only be described as exceptional. The world mourning Schultz's loss could hardly have been more different from the world that had made the cartoonist. His time had not been one of high-speed digital connectivity or nationally televised broadcast events. His time was a distant remnant of a past world. But it was this world that gave birth to the country's and perhaps the world's most lovable loser and his unlikely creator. Charles Monroe Schultz was born into the booming 1920s, but grew up during the nation's Great Depression. Schultz had fond memories of those years in Minnesota's Twin Cities. Many of his childhood memories revolved around playing sports. He especially loved baseball and played every warm day he possibly could. We played on vacant lots with baseballs that had the covers knocked off and had been taped up with black electrical tape. And we used cracked bats, he would later recall. He also played hockey with neighborhood friends, though seldomly on actual ice rinks. Instead, Schultz's father would flood their tiny backyard in the winter months, and the boys would wait for freezing weather. Only occasionally did they ever slip onto the local school rinks, and even then, they had to do so after dark and on a night when the moon gave enough light to play. More than any other sport, however, he loved golf. In high school, one of his few accomplishments, his academic performance had gone from solid in middle school to downright dreadful, was landing a place on the school golf team. Sam Snead, one of the early legends of American golf, was one of his personal heroes, and he dreamed of earning a spot in the U.S. National Open tournament. But no sport compared to his love for drawing. If there is such a thing as being born to do something, I think I was born to draw comic strips, Schultz told a Penthouse reporter in 1971. In countless interviews throughout his career, journalists saw destiny in the fact that at only 2 days old, Schultz's uncle had nicknamed him Sparky after the new horse Sparkplug in the comic strip Barney Google. Whether fate or journalistic license, this anecdote demonstrated the ubiquity of comic strips in American popular culture in the early 20th century. The boy took to drawing at an early age, beginning as far back as he could remember. Years later, when asked if he ever dreamed of such success, Schultz would reply, "Well, frankly, I guess I did expect it because, after all, it was something I had planned for since I was 6 years old." In school, he quickly distinguished himself as a budding artist. During his first week of kindergarten, the teacher asked the students to draw a picture using crayons and paper. Schultz combined an image of a man shoveling snow with a palm tree in the background. The child had blended a very familiar Minnesota image with the much more exotic plant life his mother had described to him while reading aloud letters from her relatives in Needles, California. As the teacher made her rounds in the room, she stopped over young Schultz and announced, "Someday, Charles, you're going to be an artist." His classmates took notice as well. "I used to decorate my loose-leaf binders with drawings of Mickey Mouse, the Three Little Pigs, and Popeye," he wrote. "Whenever friends in class would see these cartoons, I would be asked to draw them on their notebooks as well." Though it was still rough, this was the type of talent that demanded sharing, and Schultz's personality, always seeking the affirmation of others' happiness, was just the type to share it. There were no other artists or authors in Schultz's family, but the boy received plenty of encouragement to pursue his dream. His father, a barber who owned a shop in downtown St. Paul, possessed a practical mind and a strong work ethic. Carl Schultz was the primary reason his son did not remember those depression years and the harsh tones of so many of his contemporaries. "I always admired him," Schultz told one interviewer, "because he only had a third-grade education but worked pitching hay in Nebraska one summer to earn enough money to go to barber school, got himself a couple of jobs, and eventually bought his own barber shop. Though his father worked tirelessly to maintain his business and pay his employees, especially during the dark days of the Depression, he took special care to foster his only child's passion, comic strips. He loved to read the comic strips," Schultz remembered of his father. "We discussed them together and worried about what was going to happen next to certain of the characters. Every weekend, Schultz and his father took turns reading four different newspaper comic sections, two Minneapolis papers and two St. Paul papers. While it was not unusual for a family in these years to subscribe to a couple of papers, their dedication to the funny section was extraordinary. His mother was no less encouraging. Though she could not entirely appreciate her husband's and son's obsession with comic strips, 'How could you sit there and laugh at something out loud?' she would ask the two. 'I don't understand that.' She wanted her son to pursue his dream. In fact, she was the one who suggested he work to hone his skills as an artist through professional training. During his senior year of high school, she came across an ad for Art Instruction Schools, Inc., a cartooning correspondence course located in Minneapolis. The cost was $170, a whopping sum for the family, and yet he never heard his parents complain. Such a course suited Schultz perfectly, for he was deathly afraid of sitting in a regular art school classroom, because I'd be right back where I was in high school, in a class with a lot of people who could draw better than I could, or so Schultz later claimed. Fears of inferiority plagued the aspiring cartoonist. "I really was afraid of art school," he told another reporter, "because I didn't think I was good enough." Even when he was given the option to drop off his lessons in person, he opted to mail them in so as not to have to face the instructor. But as he studied the instructor's responses, practiced, and improved, he slowly gained the courage to go to lessons in person. His growing confidence paid off, as he found that he was indeed good enough to stand among his peers. "The first night, the instructor put up different cartoon characters from the papers that we had a copy," he remembered. Studying the smooth, curving lines of Chick Young's Blondie characters, he swiftly completed the assignment. "I was done way ahead of everybody else," he reminisced, "and I could draw them just as well as the instructor could." The young man was soaring. Now that made me feel good, because I knew then that I really had something special. He had possessed the passion for cartooning since childhood, and finally his diligent study and practice were paying major dividends as he raced to the head of his art school class. Not even a rejection letter from Walt Disney Animation Studios following his high school graduation could stand between the budding artist and his lofty dream of writing his own syndicated strip. Then the war came. He received his draft notice in late November 1942, just days after his 20th birthday. Photos from that year show a pleasant yet uncertain young man with boyish looks and slick back hair, slouching back on his heels, so slim as nearly to disappear in his loose-fitting clothes. The government's form letter could not have come at a worse time. For the last couple of years after high school graduation, the teenager had watched his mother crumble from treatment for cervical cancer. Stationed at Fort Snelling, nestled at the confluence of the Minnesota and Mississippi rivers, just south of the Twin Cities, Schultz took full advantage of the generous leave time in this phase of his service and returned home every weekend to be with his parents. All the while, his mother went in and out of the hospital, her health declining faster than doctors could keep apace. On Sunday evening, February 28th, as the draftee prepared to make his trip back to base, he reluctantly slipped through the doorway of his mother's room. There in the darkness, his mother looked away toward the wall. Like her son, she did not wish to face the moment that lingered before them. Schultz finally broke the silence to tell his mother he must be going. It was time to say goodbye. "Yes, I suppose we should say goodbye," she responded rather calmly. Slowly, painfully, she looked at her son. "Well," he recalled her saying, "goodbye, Sparky. We'll probably never see each other again." Those words hung in his mind for the rest of his life. The next day, the first day of a still wintry March, his mother's prophecy came true. Though his father raced to retrieve his son, it was not quick enough. As Schultz entered the main hall at the base to meet his father, he found him across the room on the phone, first stoic, then quietly weeping. The dreaded day had come, and the two were now alone. "Our tiny family was torn apart," Schultz lamented. The funeral followed in a blur, and then off he went to Fort Campbell, Kentucky, to prepare for deployment. Schultz was alone in a sea of unremarkable, barely distinguishable recruits like himself, one of more than 4.5 million men serving in the Army by the end of 1942. Few things were worse than being drafted, Schultz believed. Years later, the experience still brought up memories of childhood summer camps, which for him was the equivalent to being drafted. This was such a bewildering time for the newly motherless young man. Instilled with his father's sense of faithful duty, he still met World War II with the same lack of enthusiasm with which he had once faced those boyhood summer camps. In many ways, Charlie Brown's lingering depression was born of Schultz's coerced military service at this formative moment in his life. "The 3 years I spent in the Army," he later confided, "taught me all I needed to know about loneliness." Schultz found it almost unbearable to never know when he or any of his fellow soldiers would be returned home. "We used to sit around in the evenings and talk about these things," he recalled, "and we were completely convinced that we were going to be in for the rest of our lives. Trapped so far away from his father, the only person in the world I had to worry about, Schultz faced a conflict that seemed to have no end in sight. Part of his uncertainty was rooted in ceaseless training and waiting. Drafted in early 1942, he would not be deployed until February 1945, when his company boarded a retooled luxury liner in the Boston Harbor for a 13-day voyage to the newly liberated beaches of Normandy. Schultz did manage to maintain a sketchbook while he was off at war, with its cover decorated much like the notebooks he had illustrated for his classmates a few years earlier. He titled the sketchbook, "As We Were." This title established a theme for the types of drawings that filled the pages. Many of them were rather realistic sketches of the mundane daily life of soldiers, resting by their vehicles, shaving, ironing their clothes, sleeping in their bunks. These sketches resembled stylized photos, with the slender, long lines that had characterized action art in comic books and elsewhere in the 1940s. In other sequences in the book, Schultz employed a more cartoonish style, with the rounded shapes that would come to define his style. These pieces were done in the form of a single-panel editorial cartoon, and the substance lampooned the daily life of the soldier, much like the work of Bill Mauldin's Willie and Joe, then running in the military's publication Stars and Stripes. While the pages of the notebook were filled with artwork, the inside of the cover, filled with names, addresses, and personal notes from the soldiers he met along the way, told the story of a man deeply connected to people. By the time of his Atlantic passage, Schultz had proven himself to be an able soldier, working his way up to staff sergeant and leader of a light machine gun squad. In retrospect, though he would credit his time in the Army as the source of many of my problems, World War II became a major source of pride for him. Never really a tough kid, Schultz felt exonerated by World War II by becoming a squad leader because you couldn't be a sissy and be that. Nonetheless, his brief experiences with combat almost pushed him beyond his limits. After taking fire in their position outside Dachau, Schultz aimed his .50-caliber machine gun and squeezed the trigger. But no shots rang out as two German soldiers rushed out of hiding to surrender. To his own relief, Schultz had forgotten in the haste of the moment that the .50-caliber had a safety that required a second pull of the trigger to engage. Another instance required the young Minnesotan to make certain a German artillery building was clear of enemy soldiers. As he approached the entrance to toss a grenade, a small dog scampered inside in search of food. Schultz could not bring himself to harm the dog and opted to investigate the building in person. It was empty. Schultz's combat experience put him on the brink of realities that deeply unnerved him. The brink of Hitler's Holocaust. The brink of killing with his own hands. But he was never forced over. In his own estimation, he managed to fight a pretty civilized war. He returned home 25 pounds heavier and more confident than before. In a photograph with his father in late 1945, the once retreating, slender boy had clearly become a man, muscular and tall. He had survived, but was also acutely troubled by the whole experience. He was convinced that there is nothing glorious about war. Living in a small apartment above the barbershop with his father, the young veteran had no desire for a college education or a regular job. He was in pursuit of a dream deferred. After being turned down for jobs in several Twin City area art departments, he nearly landed a job lettering tombstones. He was quietly grateful when the employer never telephoned to offer him the position. In March 1946, he finally found work lettering panels at the Catechetical Guild Educational Society, publishers of a series of Catholic comic magazines called Topics Comics. This job did not accomplish the goal of publishing his own strip, but at least it was work in the comics field. He was even given the opportunity in February and April of 1947 to draw his own cartoon in Topics Comics, titled Just Keep Laughing, and pinned under his nickname, Sparky. The artwork only vaguely resembled the first panels of Peanuts that would follow 3 years later. Terribly unfocused, the characters included adults, children, and even ants in a rather unremarkable page of panels. It did, however, include a few sports-related jokes, staples in his later work. One of the panels showed a boy and girl sitting on a sidewalk, the boy with a baseball bat in hand. "You know, Judy," the boy reasoned, "I think I could learn to love you if your batting average was just a little higher." This was the first time Schultz demonstrated his potential for developing a strip about children. When his friend and mentor, Frank Wing, saw the strip, he remarked, "Sparky, I think you should draw more of these little kids. They are pretty good." 4 months later, Schultz was hired as an instructor at the art instruction school where he had previously been a student. This opportunity was beneficial to the budding artist in a number of ways. It provided him a steady income as an artist, even if it was in an educational capacity. It allowed him abundant practice on the fundamentals of line and style that would come to define his expertly composed later works. It also gave him time and space to continue honing his own original ideas and a circle of other skilled young artists to provide constructive criticisms of his work. The late 1940s were also a period of deep spiritual awakening for the young war veteran. In part to find friends and in part to explore the deeper meaning of life, Schultz began attending a Church of God congregation in St. Paul. The pastor of the church was the same man who had conducted his mother's funeral. Here he found a very active group of young people and began regularly studying the Bible with them. "The more I thought about the matter during those studying times," he wrote, "the more I realized that I really loved God." He came to attribute his surviving the years after his mother's death, the draft, and the war to the work of God. "I accepted Jesus Christ by gratitude," he articulated. There was no emotional conversion experience, nor revivalist altar call. Schultz approached Christianity the same way he approached everything else, calmly, quietly, and with his full intellect. For artistic inspiration, Schultz turned to the comic strips he loved. George Herrmann's Crazy Cat was perhaps the greatest influence on young Schultz's art. "I always thought, if I could just do something as good as Crazy Cat, I would be happy. Crazy Cat was always my goal," Schultz told Psychology Today. Crazy Cat was an anomaly in the comics. The story revolved around three characters, Crazy, a cat, Ignatz, a mouse, and Officer Pup, a dog. Herrmann set his strip in an expansive fantasy world and engaged his trio in a unique reversal of roles, where Crazy loved Ignatz, though the cat often lamented his confusion over his own gender. Ignatz tormented Crazy with bricks, and Officer Pup worked tirelessly to protect Crazy from Ignatz. The strip's biggest fan was George Herrmann's boss, William Randolph Hearst. While Crazy Cat was never a commercial success, it delighted numerous intellectuals, reportedly even President Woodrow Wilson, who would often read the strip before entering war cabinet meetings during the Great War. Herrmann's greatest strength was his unrelenting experimentation with his art and literary forms, weaving a tale that often read more like ancient fable than a mere cartoon on cheap paper. Schultz loved Herrmann's wonderful scratchy pen effect, and the fact that the strip was quite literate. Like Schultz's own work, Crazy Cat chronicled a never-ending tale of unrequited love. Schultz did not have access to the strip as a boy because it was not published in any of the Twin City papers. The strip only ran in 35 papers at the time of Herrmann's death in 1944. When a collection of Crazy Cat, with an introduction by poet E.E. Cummings, was published in 1946, It was a revelation for the young artist. He rigorously studied Harriman's style and techniques, which drove Schultz to think more deeply about his own, to create a feature that went beyond the mere actions of ordinary children. Years later, when Schultz was establishing his own place in American culture, an original Crazy Cat page hung on the wall of his studio as he drew. There were other influences as well. Milton Caniff, artist of Terry and the Pirates, 1934, and Steve Canyon, 1947, was one of Schultz's favorite action artists. Known as the Rembrandt of the comic strip, Caniff's work was cinematic with rich plots, well-developed characters, exotic settings, and lightning-fast pacing. He was enormously influential to artists of Schultz's generation and was a founding member of the National Cartoonists Society. Most of the action strips of the early 50s imitated the Caniff style, featuring dark shading and perfectly sculpted heroes and femme fatales. While Schultz did not draw an action strip, he did focus on character development and extended storylines, keys to Caniff's success. Al Capp's Lil Abner, 1934, a wildly popular comic strip that parodied rural America, was also an important influence. Capp's strip was highly political, sarcastic, and satirical, nothing like Peanuts, but influential in Schultz's love for comic strips nonetheless. Roy Crane was perhaps the greatest influence among the artists Schultz followed as a child. His famous Wash Tubs, 1924, mixed realistic characters and settings with a more cartoonish lead character. He also mixed in minimalist panels alongside his more detailed ones. These prominent cartoonists all influenced an entire generation of artists after them. Schultz was only unique in the way he blended their particular strengths and contributions with his own style and ideas. In the summer of 1947, Schultz published a few panels with the Minneapolis Tribune.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.